Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Before we begin today's topic, I'd like to remind you that next week's video will be our monthly Q&A section. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comment section or send me an email if you prefer to be anonymous. I will do my best to answer questions. Together, we can surely make our community better. We are now in the fall season in Canada and the most likely March of the Northern Hemisphere. In my experience, fall is the best season to practice martial arts. So, if you live in an area with the similar climatic conditions as Canada, now is the right time to practice more. According to TCM, the body tends to accumulate a lot of shiqi or dampness during the summer. Ramping up your practice during the fall will strengthen your yang energy, which will help you expel this dampness out of your body. So, in martial practice, you can increase the intensity and even sweat more. Of course, it is a good idea to sleep more after practicing, since in the summertime, our sleeping pattern normally is not ideal compared to the fall season. Since most of us, if not all, practice martial arts, shudao, and other exercise with the goal of improving the quality of life, I highly recommend using seasonal changes to your advantage. That would involve lifestyle adjustments, including but not limited to intensity of practice, diet, sleep, and other factors in order to make your body stronger and healthier, thus leading to a better life. Today, I'd like to introduce shuangzhong, a negative term that often confuses many people in the internal style community, especially the Tai Chi community. I call shuangzhong a negative term because it is something you should be careful to avoid in your practice. Shuangzhong describes an unwanted practice. The counterpart for shuangzhong is danzhong, a term for correct practice. Avoidance of shuangzhong has effectively become more important than the cultivation of danzhong, which may be problematic, but it's still a step in the right direction. So, it is worth talking about shuangzhong to avoid incorrect practice. Topics covered in today's video include: first, origin of the term shuangzhong. Second, different explanations for shuangzhong. Third, my interpretation of shuangzhong. Fourth, common principles to avoid shuangzhong. Fifth, demonstration, and sixth, correction of a student's practice. Then seventh, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1. Origin of the term shuangzhong. Shuangzhong consists of two characters. Shuang means two or double, while zhong means weight, heavy, important, and so on, depending on the context. Also, there are other pronunciations of this character. For example, the character of zhong can be pronounced as chong, which has a totally different meaning. Nothing to do with martial practice. So, I won't go any further into them. Put together, shuangzhong translates to double-weighted or double-weightedness. So, what is this double-weightedness? Well, there is no unanimous agreement on the meaning of shuangzhong. It's hard to give a simple answer to this question since it requires a much detailed explanation. A literal translation and explanation will not provide any help to your practice. Now, that would make you wonder if there is a widely accepted definition of this term. Well, none so far to the best of my knowledge, which is why I will provide you with my own definition and explanation of shuangzhong. Like I have mentioned in prior videos, knowing the origin of a term will go a long way in helping you understand the term. So, where, when, and how did Shuangzhong originate? Well, based on current available documents, Shuangzhong was first mentioned in one of the most important Tai Chi documents ever, called Tai Chi Quan Lun, or Discussion of Tai Chi Quan, believed to be written by Wang Zhongyue about 400 years ago. In that document, Wang Zhongyue said, "Pian Chen Ze Sui, Shuang Zhong Ze Zhi, Mei Jian Shu Nian Chun Gong Bu Neng Yun Hua Zhe, Jie Shuai Jie Zi Wei Ren Zhi, Shuang Zhong Zhi Bing Wei Wu Er." It translated to, "By thinking one side, you will be able to follow your opponent. Shuang Zhong will cause stiffness. Very often, even people with many years of practice cannot master this art and get controlled by others in application, due to a lack of understanding of Shuangzhong." End translation. I have intentionally left Shuangzhong untranslated here. We can see that the misunderstanding of the term Shuangzhong is a mistake that leads to a poor practice of Tai Chi. Shuangzhong, unfortunately, is one of the many terms mentioned in old martial art documents without any clear definition, even though the author Wang Zhongyue presented a solution to avoid Shuangzhong. To the end, Wang Zhongyue said, quote, "Yu bi zi bing, xu zhi yin yang," end quote. Oh, to avoid this mistake, you have to understand yin and yang. End translation. That's simple, isn't it? Everybody knows yin and yang, so everyone can easily avoid Shuangzhong. Of course, I'm kidding. Well, there are two problems here. First, Wang Zhongyue did not provide any explanation for Shuangzhong. Second, he also mentioned understanding yin and yang as a solution to avoiding Shuangzhong, but didn't explain yin and yang in this context either. Over the years, yin and yang have become so co-opted that they could mean anything and everything or even nothing at all in this context. Merely going by Wang Zhongyue's word without fully understanding the subtext will only take you practice so far. Unfortunately, practitioners of older generations wrote martial documents mainly with the intention of recording their understanding of a technique and not with the intention of teaching or propagating their techniques, which is something I have already pointed out in prior videos. You could say those documents are more like a personal diary, not intended for teaching or sharing. As a result, only someone with skills comparable to the author could fully understand the true meaning behind the author's words. Reproducibility of the knowledge and the skill through documents alone would be impossible for untrained practitioners, regardless of the amount of time spent in practice. This is one of the major shortcomings in the knowledge transfer process throughout Chinese history, which hindered the development in China compared to the rest of the world. Anyway, back to the topic of Shuangzhong. Since Wang Zhongyue didn't provide any clear explanation, practitioners of later generations attempted to provide their own based on their understanding. Which brings us to the next topic. Topic 2. Different explanations of Shuangzhong. Topic 2. Different explanations for Shuangzhong. Many famous Tai Chi masters, including Yang Shengfu, explained Shuangzhong when interpreting Wang Zhongyue's article, Tai Chi Quan Lun, or Discussion of Tai Chi Quan. All of those explanations can be broadly categorized into three types. Of course, there are some new interpretations as well, But overall, those three categories include all the noteworthy explanations. I will introduce the three categories first, followed by their explanations and criticism, and finally provide my own interpretation of Shuangzhong. Category 1. Shuang means two opponents, and Zhong means heavy force, which means that in a combat situation, two opponents simply use force against force. Category 2. Shuang means your own two feet. Zhong means your body weight distribution on your feet. According to this interpretation, Shuangzhong is when your body weight is evenly distributed over both feet in a stance, a mistake in martial practice, and Category 3. Shuang means the hand and the foot on the same side of the body. Zhong means substantial force of strength. According to this interpretation, it would be considered as Shuangzhong when both the hand and the foot at the same side apply a substantial force or strength compared to the practice that hand and foot on the same side do not apply a substantial force at the same time. Of course, physically speaking, weight is a type of force, but in this context, force involves the intended martial effort, which goes beyond mere weight. In Chinese martial practice, people use the word shi or substantial to express application of the force. I have a prior video titled Substantial and Insubstantial Internal Style Concepts No. 8. Link is in the description. Substantial and insubstantial are an important pair of concepts in Chinese martial practice. So I recommend you take a look if you haven't already. I have to acknowledge that all three categories of explanations of Shuangzhong have their own advantages and disadvantages. So let's dive into each of them. Consider Category 1, which interprets Shuangzhong as force against force. A common term used to describe this situation is Ding, which is the shortened form of Ding Niu, or two balls locking horns. Tai Chi practice involves the famous eight gate forces concept to describe eight kinds of forces. Peng, Lui, Ji, An, Cai, Lie, Zhou, Kao. I have a video titled Tai Chi and its eight gate forces, from theory to practice. Link is in the description. In that video, I have explained the eight gate forces in detail. Please have a look if you haven't already. So, if two opponents apply the same type of force in combat, for example, when both Lui force is used by both parties, it would be considered a double-weighted situation of Shuangzhong. Now, the question becomes, does force against force guarantee failure in martial application? Well, let's analyze. Under this situation, there are only three possible outcomes. First, you have a stronger force compared to your opponent. Result, you win. Second, both you and your opponent have equal force. Result, 50-50 chance. Third, your opponent have a stronger force compared to you. Result, your opponent wins. So, statistically speaking, the odds can be anywhere from 33% to 66% that you will win, but no guarantee failure, which contradicts the prior interpretation that you will always lose. In real combat, if you see an opponent where your opponent has a weak point, then you should attack that weak point with all your power, even though it may look like a force against force situation. This is why the first interpretation of Shuangzhong as a force against force situation between opponents is not precise. Now, let's consider Category 2, which interprets equal weight dispution over both feet to be shuangzhong or something to avoid in martial practice. This would lead you to believe that you should never distribute weight equally between both feet. Unfortunately, there will always be a moment in the weight shifting process where both of your feet will evenly support your body weight, whether you like it or not. Would such a moment give you opponent the best opportunity to attack you since you are double weighted? Well, not at all. We can say that the situation that people with many years of practice cannot master this art and get controlled by others in application is not caused by the even weight distribution on two feet. Even if equal weight distribution on both feet is the major issue, then it is not hard to avoid this mistake. So, this situation doesn't always guarantee failure. Therefore, evenly distribution your body weight between both feet is not the interpretation of a shuangzhong. Now, let's look at category 3, which considers shuangzhong as the situation when the hand and the foot on the same side apply a substantial force simultaneously. This is the most popular interpretation for shuangzhong. Basically, the term substantial and insubstantial is the comparative martial effort of force manifestation. Consider the ball stance, for instance. The front leg has a smaller angle behind the knee and is considered unsubstantial. And the back leg has a much larger angle behind the knee and is considered substantial. I will use the term physical weight and mental weight to explain the concept. We all know that physical weight is. Now, mental weight is basically the origin of the martial force. Since the physical weight is on the leg, which has a smaller angle behind the knee, it is considered unsubstantial since other leg is the one that generates power and applies more force in martial practice. Thus, the barrier of mental weight. In this context, the leg that bears the mental weight is always the substantial one. So, think about it. Going by this interpretation, you need to avoid applying more force on the leg intentionally, even though it supports most of your body weight. Now, let's talk about the hand in this context. If the foot is insubstantial, then the hand on the same side should not be substantial and vice versa, or else it becomes a shuangzhong situation. Unfortunately, there are many situations where the hand and the foot on both sides apply substantial force simultaneously, which cannot be avoided in most cases. Furthermore, it can get even more complicated if we analyze different situations of a shuangzhong. In the interest of time, I will leave this to you as an exercise for self-evaluation. If you have any questions as a result, I can possibly answer them in the Q&A video. Therefore, among those three categories of interpretations of the term shuangzhong or double-weightedness, the third category is a bit more complicated than the others, but seems the most reasonable in practice. This is why this is the most popular interpretation in the community so far. Also, based on my teaching experience, this method is very effective in teaching martial details. If you are a teacher, you should apply the shuangzhong concept in analyzing the weight distribution, source of power, and the martial intent involved in each movement of your students. This will greatly improve the quality of your teaching and, of course, directly benefit your students. If you are an internal style practitioner, paying attention to each detail by applying the third method can help you master the inner connection of each martial aspect better. In other words, the third method is the valuable solution in both learning and teaching. However, given that we noted obviously deficiencies in the third interpretation, should we just make peace with it and move on? Not at all. I think we can do better. That brings us to the next topic. Topic 3. My interpretation of Shuangzhong. Very often, a simple practice becomes complicated over time. On one hand, it could be a good thing because it would reflect the development and evolution of the style, since any technique system usually follows the path starting from the simple to the more sophisticated. For example, Tai Chi, a martial system created originally for self-defense, morphed over the centuries into a style full of jargon, confusing concepts and even more confused practitioners. On the other hand, abundance of hypotheses and theory can often have the unintended consequence of hindering the further development of a style. Even worse, obfuscation and selective sharing of knowledge lead to only a few people learning a style, which eventually leads to its extinction. With these aspects in mind, I describe Shuangzhong to be an incorrect practice. As a result, Shuangzhong can be caused by multiple factors, often acting together. Now, let's go back to Wang Zhongyue's original mention of Shuangzhong. Since Wang Zhongyue did not explain the meaning of Shuangzhong, people naturally tried to figure out a solution to prevent it, even though they didn't fully understand what it meant to begin with. So, in order to understand the meaning of Shuangzhong, we have to know what Shuangzhong is in the context of his original writing. Let me quote his original writing again. 偏臣则随, 双重则治, end quote. This translates to, by thinking one side, you will be able to follow the opponent's movement. Shuangzhong will cause stiffness. You have to know that in Hanyu or Chinese language, authors always try to use antithesis for poetic effect. With that in mind, let's look at the mistake described by Wang Zhongyue. The first sentence, 偏臣则随, can be translated to mean one side thinking and one side thinking can followed by the movement of your opponent, which is the basic Tai Chi principle. So the opposite of 偏臣 or one side thinking is two side action, which creates 滞 or stiffness. Therefore, any movement that can stiffen your practice can be considered a part of the Shuangzhong. If you read Wang Dongyue's words carefully, Shuangzhong should not be narrowed down to mere coordination issues between the hands, feet, arms, legs, and so on. Now, you may consider many situations based on your own understanding to be Shuangzhong, but it does not mean that your hypothesis reflects Wang Zhongyue's original intention, since he did not explain it in the first place. My research has led me to conclude that Shuangzhong is a situation involving stiffness in movement caused by multiple factors, including but not limited to incorrect postures and movements. So, are there any specific situations that can cause stiffness in martial practice? Well, standing posture or the weight distribution is considered one of the main culprits. In conclusion, Shuangzhong is just an incorrect standing position that can cause stiffness in the body during martial movements, as simple as that. By the way, there is another possible translation of the first sentence with a totally opposite meaning. The translation is, if you are weak on one side, your structure will collapse, which indicates another mistake. The word 随 in the sentence becomes a negative term used to express the situation that a practitioner is off balance. No matter what, the main focus should be on the second sentence, specifically the term 双重, nothing else. So, in order to avoid further confusion, let's skip the further discussion about the different translations for now. Now, let's consider 双重 in the context of 形意. I would like to introduce two important 形意 concepts regarding 双重. The first was provided by Guo Yunshen and the second by Xue Dian. If you are not familiar with these names, I recommend you watch my prior videos introducing them. Links are in the description. Guo Yunshen said, when you practice Santi stance, both feet should maintain a single-weighted posture instead of a double-weighted posture. Single-weighted posture is not that you stand with only one foot on the ground. It is the posture that puts more weight on your back foot. Even though there is a double-weighted posture externally, internally you should distribute your weight according to the single-weighted method. Furthermore, Guo Yunshen explained the reason as quoted. When you keep your single-weighted posture, the body is flexible and is much suitable to generate the power in martial application. With double-weighted posture, makes the movement less flexible and stiff. You can analyze for yourself that the reason for avoiding the double-weighted posture is for martial application and relies on the position of the feet in terms of weight distribution. However, Guo Yunshen emphasized towards the end of his article that after you master the practice, your practice should naturally and subconsciously handle weight distribution and foot positioning by focusing on neither single-weightedness or double-weightedness. In other words, as long as your practice naturally at an advanced level, it should not be of any concern. Xue Dian, another legendary Xing Yi master in Xing Yi history, talked about the same concept as Guo Yunshen. Furthermore, he said that distributing the weight equally on both feet is the martial way since it can better help you build physical strength. However, he emphasized that Xing Yi practice should focus on the Dao Yi, or the art of Dao, which is higher standard compared to martial practice alone. He said that only the single-weighted stance will have the benefit of Dao Yi since it follows the natural way of internal style practice. To summarize, I define 双重 as an incorrect practice that causes the body to lack flexibility due to incorrect stance, and it can be easily corrected by paying attention to your weight distribution during practice. The coordination between the feet, the legs, the arms, and the hands can be improved by paying attention in practice by following certain common principles, which brings us to the next topic. Topic 4. Common principles to avoid 双重. There are many basic guiding principles useful toward avoiding 双重. Today, I'd like to point out two of them. First, 分清虚实. Fen means differentiate, qing means clearly, xu means unsubstantial, shi means substantial. Put together, it means that in practice, you have to pay attention to your weight distribution between both feet. Furthermore, any hand movement should also follow the concept of xu-shi, or substantial and insubstantial as well, since both hand and foot should coordinate with each other in practice. Second, 不随身患. 不 means stepping, 随 means follows, 身 means body, Huan means change. Put together, it means that when the body structure changes, the stepping method should change as well. In other words, stepping follows the change in body structure, since this structural change is the main source of power in martial application. Again, coordination is the key. I'm aware this sounds abstract and confusing without an example. I have a plan to talk about this topic more in the future with a detailed demonstration. Topic 5, demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate a Xingyi exercise used to improve body flexibility. One simple exercise to improve Xingyi flexibility. Okay? You can start from here, from this posture. Then in, then strike, in, strike, back, turn, turn, then strike, turn, then back. Topic 6, correction of student's practice. I'd like to ask my students to demonstrate the Xue Dian style of dragon movement, and then I correct his movement. Okay, you start. One. Then slowly. Do not need to make a low posture, just natural posture. Yes, continue. One, two, three, one more time. One, okay, two, three. Now you move back, just in the middle. Yes, in the middle. Overall is good, but let's improve the practice. You keep this posture. Yes, first of all, maybe you can turn 30 degrees so that the audience easy to see you. Yes, first of all, you keep the posture ready. Okay, first, open a little bit more. Second, grabbing motion, like grabbing motion. Third thing is the in that finger point toward here, not so much back, a little bit here. And put the weight a little bit on the back leg, a little bit more. Shoulder extend forward. Look at this direction, this area. And more, in that finger straight. Yes. Then one, shoulder extend more. Then, yes. In that finger one. Then two, extend the chest. Then three. Then slowly, foot land first, then palm. Right, slowly, then again, extend. Weight more on the back. On the back. See, weight more on the back. Shoulder extend forward. Then, right. It's good. Now you can stop. Thank you. Topic 7, takeaways. First, origin of the term Shuangzhong is from Wang Zongyue's Tai Chi document, a term without a clear explanation. Second, three types of explanation for the Shuangzhong concept. A simple term becomes so complicated due to many reasons. Third, I define Shuangzhong as an incorrect practice that causes the body to lack flexibility due to incorrect stance, and it can be easily corrected by paying attention to your weight distribution during practice. Two simple principles to avoid Shuangzhong mistakes have been introduced, including Fen Qing Xu Shi and Bu Sui Shen Huan. Fifth, remember to check out the demonstration and the student correction sections. That brings us to the end of today's video. A quick reminder to post your questions in the comment area or email me if you prefer to be anonymous. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.